We're going to be in Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16. It's interesting how already they're advertising for Christmas, you know. And it's all going to start this week. And everybody's going to be shopping. And as Christians, I pray that I can get you to see today. I'm going to read this story in the Acts of the Apostles of Paul and Silas. And they were in a terrible situation. Now, hopefully for a lot of us, we love Christmas and it's an awesome time. But every year I hear these stories of people telling me, oh, if I only didn't have to go there, if I only didn't have to do this, if this were not going to have to take place. And so no matter whether this is the best time of the year or the worst time of the year, or no matter where you're at, I really believe the Holy Spirit's goal this morning is to get you to look at whatever your situation is and see that God can use it for salvation. And that you will see what needs to be done and what your part is and what God's part is. And we can become this army that brings salvation to everyone we meet. All right? With that, I'm going to start in Acts chapter 16 in the 22nd verse. Let me set the scene for you. Paul and Silas are in Philippi, and they stir quite a thing up when the fortune teller, this young lady who's a fortune teller, starts following Paul around and his group of men, and she starts to proclaim that these men are servants of the Most High God. They will show you the way to salvation. Now, I would have made her my press secretary. But you see, she had a demonic spirit in her. And the Apostle Paul one day turned around and told that spirit to leave her. And when he did, he was wrecking this awesome business the men that owned her had. And they got so upset because that spirit left her and she could no longer tell the future, and they lost their business, that they took Paul and Silas and they had them beaten and thrown in prison, all right? And we're going to pick up the story here. And once again, think about the situation you're in. These guys were in a terrible situation. And we're going to read what comes of it. It says, the crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. Upon receiving such orders, he put them in the inner cell, and he fastened their feet in stocks. What would you do if that were your situation? It's a great question, isn't it? Listen to what these two guys do. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everybody's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out, and he asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." And then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them, and he washed their wounds. And then immediately he and all his family were baptized. The jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole family. Heavenly Father, I lift up whole families to you today, that, Lord, we would minister to one another, and that, Lord, wherever we go, wherever our feet travel, you'll give us that territory, just like you told Joshua, and that, Lord, we can be instruments of righteousness, and we can take a difficult situation and watch the power of your Spirit turn it for salvation. Holy Spirit, just guide us today in Jesus' precious name. Amen. What must I do to be saved? The heading there, to be saved. Verse 25, prayer and praise is good in all places and at all times. Sometimes you just don't feel like praying. Sometimes you just don't feel like praising. I want to suggest to you that any time is a good time to pray, and any time is a good time to praise. And mostly when you don't feel like it, if you're depressed, if you're down, if you're hurt, if somebody just ran over you with their truck. Prayer and praise is always a good idea. And once again, what do you do when you're in trouble? What do you do when you get into a terrible spot? Here, Paul and Silas at midnight in an ugly prison. I'm telling you, it wasn't nice there. There were no equal rights here. They had been beaten. Their wounds had not been cleaned. They were in severe pain. They were given no medication. And they were put in the top security in the prison, in the inner prison, and their feet were put in stocks, and they were stuck right there. And it says that they began to pray, and they began to sing hymns, and everybody heard them. The other thing you have to know is sometimes when you think you're just having a little conversation, there can be people listening all around. Your next point, prayer and praise is capable of the miraculous. I still believe in the miraculous. I think these things happen every day. But when you're in prayer and when you're praising God and you're worshiping God, I believe it just opens the door for God to move. And it's capable of the miraculous. In the text, verses 27 and 28, it says, the jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, don't harm yourself, we're all here. Look at the point. Prisoners are identified and freed. You see, when we begin to read this story, it's clear that Paul and Silas are the prisoners. They're locked up. They're tied up in chains. And it looks to me like the jailer is in control, doesn't it? It seems like he's the authority. But oh, how it changed. Don't miss the point. Prisoners are identified and freed. Who really is a prisoner and who's really free? I want to tell you right now, the unsaved people out there, they think we are in prison because we're in church this morning. Can you believe it? They never tasted the cookies our ladies bake. But they think, you know, oh, how many times do you hear it? Oh, religion, that's a crutch, man. I'm free. Yeah, you're free, all right. Ask the jailer how free he was. Suicide is not the answer. It just tears me up when I think of the number of people who will be so sad this Christmas season, this Thanksgiving, that they'll take their own life because they think there's no hope and things aren't the way they used to be and nobody's there to help them and they're all alone. It's not the answer. Your next point, true authority is revealed. What would you have done if you were Paul in this situation? Huh? If this jailer's the guy that beat you, and he inflicted pain on you, and he threw you in that jail, and he locked your feet up, and maybe he left you a glass of water that was almost close enough that you could reach it. And if you saw him draw his sword to take his life, because he knew if the prisoners escaped, he was a dead man anyway as a Roman soldier. What would you have done? I think some of those prisoners were going, Paul, what's wrong with you? Let him go. But suddenly he shouts out, "Hey, don't harm yourself. We're all here." You see, the fact is the true authority is revealed. Paul, because he has the power of God's Holy Spirit and because he has salvation and he understands redemption. Isn't it amazing that there's no unforgiveness here? And that he cares about a man's soul who's done nothing but harm him. And yet he says, "Don't harm yourself. We're all here." And the real authority comes to light. You know who's really in authority? The one that has the power of God's Holy Spirit in any situation. Because they can kill you here on this earth and you know where you're going. If God is for me, who can be against me? What can they do? But I have the true power. It's the power of God's Holy Spirit. It's the knowledge of the hereafter and where I'm going to be and where I will enter into for eternity. And the true authority suddenly comes to light. I want you to see that this thing turns around so fast. And suddenly the guy in chains is set free and he's in charge. I wonder what Paul would have said when they locked him in the stocks if you would have said to him, "You know, you're going to baptize the jailer in just a couple hours." I wonder if he would have gone, "Well, of course, that's my whole intention." Or he would have gone, "Yeah, right." When you get ready to go to a family gathering and somebody would say to you, "Maybe you can lead somebody to the Lord today," I got a feeling a bunch of us would go, "Right." We'd probably quote scripture. Say, "A prophet's without honor in his own home." Things like that. But if I could get you today to turn around and to look at the story and see what the power of God can do in a moment. Verse 30, the question we long to hear. "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Wow. Your response to that has to be, open up your gospel truck and drive in. You have to know how to answer. Your next point, we must be ready to answer correctly. Verse 31, they replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household." And then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. Somewhere, you know, if you read between the lines, I think the jailer said, "Who is this Jesus? Is this a guy I heard about that they crucified?" And maybe they had to tell him, "Yeah, but he rose from the dead and he's the Son of God and he was born of a virgin," you see. But you have to be ready to answer the question correctly. Now, as you look at the text, I want you to realize what he does not say. What must I do to be saved? Do you notice Paul didn't say you ought to shut this prison down, man? You got terrible food here. Get a new job. That tattoo's got to go. Cut your hair. Change the color of the carpet. Do you see all the things that he didn't mention? I'll bet the guy's house was full of idols, Roman idols. Did you notice he didn't say, "Well, get rid of that there. That's got to go. This got to go. Hey, this stuff that you gave me to eat, was it sacrificed to an idol?" I'll bet it was. I can't touch that. Did you notice he doesn't say any of that? He said, "What must I do to be saved?" He said, "You have to believe on the Lord Jesus." Because that's what you have to do. Believe on the Lord Jesus. So many people say it can't be that easy. It can't be that simple. To which I say it is that simple. It caused the Apostle Paul to say, I fear that some of you have strayed from the simplicity of the gospel. And you've added so much to it. And you've messed it up so badly that it takes hours to get down to Jesus. And the fact is, you have to believe on the Lord Jesus. Verses 33 and 34, the desired results. It says that they baptized him that night. At that hour, they took him, they washed their wounds, and immediately he and all his family, they were baptized. It just amazes me. There were no board meetings to say, do you really think we should let this guy into the body of Christ? I don't even see that he went through a quiz. Do you realize this guy's never been to church and he was baptized? They baptized him in the name of Jesus. He was set free. Your next heading, the importance of confessing Jesus and believing. The importance of confessing Jesus and believing. We're going to Romans chapter 10. I'm going to read the first 17 verses because I want you to see this. I want you to see what Paul says. Now, he starts out talking about the Jews, but by the end of this, he wants Jews, Gentiles, everybody he can find to be saved. And it's the same for all of them. Brothers, we hear, or my heart's desire and prayer to God for you Israelites is that they may be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God. But their zeal is not based on knowledge, since they did not know the righteousness that comes from God. And they sought to establish their own. They did not submit to God's righteousness. Can you submit to God's way of salvation today? Can you bend your knee to God? Christ is the end of the law, so there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Moses describes in this way the righteousness that is by the law, that man who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the deep? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith we are proclaiming. Are you ready? Don't miss this verse now. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Those are the sweetest words. It is with your heart that you believe and are justified. And it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As the scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Are you worried about being embarrassed? Listen to what it says. If you put your trust in Jesus, you will not be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. Who does God bless? The ones who call on him, who confess him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Not all the Israelites accepted the good news, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our message? Verse 17, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. Powerful words. The importance of confessing Jesus and believing. So many people say, but I wouldn't know what to do. How does someone get saved? What has to happen? It has absolutely nothing to do with you. Turn to your neighbor and say, woo, am I glad to hear that. Take off the pressure. You just might be the messenger God uses. And the Spirit of God goes to work. It amazes me, people that come up. I find them everywhere. I find them here at the altar. I find them out on the street. I find them when we're riding motorcycles. I find them in the garages when I'm fixing a garage door. And you know what they want to know? What do I have to do to be saved? What does it really take? How can I know? This is what I say to them. I say, who do you believe Jesus is? And I say, speak it out. Tell them you believe he's the Son of God. And they'll say, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I say, I just heard you confess Jesus. Have you ever sinned? Oh, yeah. I said, good, me too. Tell God you've sinned. Do you believe Jesus died on the cross to forgive you? Yeah, I do. Then ask him for forgiveness. Tell him you've sinned. And they speak it out. You see, they confess it. Ask him to come, be your Lord, be your Savior. Open up your heart, let him in. And now when the devil tells you this was worthless, call me up and I'll tell you that I heard you confess Jesus. I'll tell him I heard you. Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 and 33. Look at what it says. Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. And then it goes on to say, whoever disowns me before men, I will disown him before my Father in heaven. Do you think it's important to acknowledge Jesus? Yes, it's very important to confess him. In the old King James, it doesn't say acknowledge. It says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. When you say, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. Jesus says, Dad, did you hear that? That's one of ours. But if you deny him and you say, ooh, I probably shouldn't say anything about Jesus today because they could sue me or I could get fired. I might be reprimanded for speaking the name of my Savior. That's silence in heaven. It's so important to acknowledge him. 1 John chapter 4. Verse 15, it says it like this. It says, if anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. See how important it is to acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of God. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 5. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but what? But will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. Why? Because you acknowledge Jesus Christ as the Son of God. In your outline, I've printed the Strong's definition of that word, to acknowledge, to confess. And it just looks so odd to me. It doesn't even fit. I thought it would just say, you know, speak out openly or something like that. But do you see what it says? It says it means a resemblance, like as, a similitude. You know what it means? It means you're identifying that you're in God's family. You're saying, yeah, Jesus is my brother. God the Father, he's my dad. The Spirit of God dwells in me. I own the family. I take them on. They've taken me on. I'm part of their family. I've been adopted. I have people all the time who ask me if my older brother's younger brother. And the first thing I say is, well, first, do you like him or don't you like him? I want to know, like, do I want to acknowledge it here or don't I want to acknowledge it? We can't do that with our Savior. You can't test the landscape and see if it's a popular move or an unpopular move. You got to jump in and be part of the family. You have to identify with Christ. You take him as your own. He's in you. You're in him. The Father and the Spirit. Man, if you've listened to Pastor Michael's teaching recently on a Wednesday night, he's just hammered this in the Gospel of John. Our identity with Christ. where they say, hey, Lord, just show us your dad and everything will be good. And he says, have I been with you so long, Philip? Come on, man. Here I am. I want to live in you. Jesus wants to be proclaimed in our life. We have to own it. We have to identify with him. Christianity is not something we do on Sunday morning. Christianity is who I am. I wake up every morning a child of the King, forgiven, no guilt, no shame. Those who call on the name of the Lord will never be put to shame. But will you speak it or do you hide? Brings us to the next point, the danger of not confessing. The Gospel of John, chapter 9, when Jesus heals the blind, the young man who's blind, verses 22 and 23, and they're trying to figure out, you know, the scribes and Pharisees, who did this and what happened and did he have authority? And then they came and they asked his parents, and his parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. They said, hey, he's of age. You talk to him yourself. We don't know what happened to our son. They were afraid of the Jews, for already the Jews had decided. Anyone who listened to this, acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ, would be put out of the synagogue. That is why his parents said, he's of age. Ask him. We're not getting into this. I don't discuss religion or politics. Oh, yes, you do. We're not going to say, we're not going to speak, we won't acknowledge. If you acknowledge him, we're putting you out of the place. John chapter 12, verses 42 through 46. Yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him, speaking of Jesus. But because of the Pharisees, they would not confess their faith for fear they would be put out of the synagogue, for they love the praise from men more than praise from God. Then Jesus cried out, when a man believes in me, he does not believe in me only, but in the one who sent me. And when he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light so that no one who believes in me should stay in the darkness. The danger of not confessing Jesus. Do you love the praise of men more than the approval of God? 2 John verse 7. Might say it even more clearly. Many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh have gone out into the world. Any such person is the deceiver and the antichrist. I love this politically correct Bible that I have. Do you see how he says it? He says, if you will not acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of God, you're the antichrist. You're against him. You're either for him or you're against him. What's it going to be? It's hard to walk on the fence. There's such a danger of not confessing Jesus. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 11, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. When Pastor Michael says, hey, what's God saying to you lately? I can only say one thing. God keeps telling me, you got to bend your knee to me. You have to bow your knee to me. When I say things, God, I don't understand. Why is this happening? Why can't we change this? Why is it turning out the way it is? And he says it over and over, you got to bend your knee to me. Confess. Acknowledge me. Let your will become my will. I love this text because sooner or later, everybody's going to acknowledge Jesus as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Don't you think it would go better if we do it right now? Isn't it better to give up right now and give in? One of my favorite written sermons starts out like this: young man, your arms are too short to box with God. And I say, amen. If you've been fighting him, give in. The last point, necessity of a messenger. Back to Romans. The necessity of being a messenger. In Romans chapter 10, verses 14 and 15, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? And as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. It's so important that you're ready with an answer to give an account of the hope that is within you. Acts 16, 31 and 32, they replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. And then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. I just love to say, go ahead, ask me questions. Ask me questions about faith. Ask me questions about Jesus. As we close this morning, I just want to share with you, there's so much stuff out there, disputable matters out there that people will bring up. And you know what they're trying to, they're not actually even trying to do it, but the enemy is trying to keep you from getting to the main point that Jesus is the Son of God. And in order to be saved, you have to acknowledge him and you have to confess him. And the things that I hear are just unbelievable, that take people away from the truth, and they never get to the point that Jesus is or is not the Son of God. And they will debate so many things with you, Christian. The hot topics right now. Well, I can't be a Christian because you hate homosexuals. I hear it over and over and over. And I say to him, that is not correct. I do not hate them. My Savior, see, the goal, you have to get them to the main point. My Savior, Jesus Christ, died on the cross for them, and he loves them, and I love them too. And then they start with the yeah buts. And it goes on and on. But you guys don't believe in abortion, and on and on and on. And I'm like, yeah, okay. Now, let's get back here. Who do you say Jesus is? No, we'll catch that later. Let's get to the main point. Who do you say Jesus is? And if you will be persistent, you will get to the point where somebody will acknowledge he is who he says he is or he isn't. And now you've gotten somewhere. Now it's time to go to work, you see. Now turn to your neighbor and say, we'll never change him. Go ahead, say it. Only the Spirit of God will change them. You know how he does it? When you speak God's word to them. When you speak his word, God's word will haunt them, hunt them. They will wake up in the middle of the night thinking of what you quoted to them. And you're the messenger. But you have to get to the main point. You have to keep the main point, the main point. The main point is Jesus is the Savior who died on the cross for the forgiveness of sins. Yeah, but Pastor, I heard you guys speak in tongues there. Okay, great. Now, who is Jesus? No, but I heard that you guys do weird things. Okay, good. Now, who is Jesus? And then I say, please come and see how weird we really are. Come on in. But you guys believe this. I believe in baptism, you know, by sprinkling and baptizing babies. But you guys baptize older people and you totally submerge them. And I say, yep, good. Okay, we'll argue about that later. But who do you say Jesus is? Yeah, but no. Come here. Who is he? Once again, Paul didn't tell the jailer, man, it stinks in your jail. Cut your hair, take out your earring, get that ridiculous outfit off. He didn't say any of that. He said, believe on the Lord Jesus, you will be saved. Church, it is my prayer that this year, as we celebrate the birth of our Savior, that you will just keep taking people back to the question, who do you say Jesus is? Who is Jesus to you? As we close, I want to remind you of the indisputable matters. The indisputable matters are Jesus is the Son of God who came in the flesh, born of a virgin. He suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified. He died. He was buried for our sin. He took our place. He's the ransom. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He's seated at the right hand of God the Father, and he's coming again. And I am amazed at how many people that I sit down with who think they're so different than I am, and they think that they can never go to heaven. And they've actually been told because, you know, they love somebody that's a sinner, they can't go to heaven. And I have to explain to them, no, you're being just like your Savior who died for that sinner. That doesn't disqualify you, it qualifies you. Now again, who do you say Jesus is? And I leave more meetings with people going, we're a whole lot closer and believing the same thing than I thought we were. And I say, yeah, and the key is what you believe. Those indisputable matters that I believe in, I think we're going to spend heaven together. And they open their hearts to God, and in years down the line, you see that they've let go of all those things they were worried about out there. Father, I come to you today in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, we're coming on such an important time in our nation and in our year when we celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, take all those distractions away. Take all those things on the fringe away that everybody argues about and everybody worries about and everybody wants to make it the main thing. Take it away and let Jesus, our Lord and Savior, be the main thing in our life, the main person. Let us confess him and acknowledge him, and let us be part of his family, and let us open our hearts to let him in so that, Lord, we are completely 110% sold out for you. Lord, let the world around us see it. Let us not be ashamed. And Lord, use us as instruments of righteousness to bring in this harvest of souls. Use us to extend grace and mercy to those who think there's no hope for them this season. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. If you need prayer, I'd love to pray for you. If you need time at the altar, you can take time at the altar. If not, you're free to go in peace to love and serve the Lord. God bless you.